Oh
Testing,
yes,
testing.
that's working lovely. Okay, welcome everyone to Tuesday, March 1st, 2016. This is the Keshe Plasma Reactor Group, and I think we're ready to begin here. Basically, we've got a few people online, and who knows how many on live stream. And let me see, what do we have for the topic today? Who would like to begin today's meeting with their topic of interest? Mario, you got something you want to speak about? Or Libby, John, any others? Danny? Bring out those topics. Let's get going.
I have something. I built another reactor this week.
No?
I was able to wire the original one. If I could show you it,
Sure.
it's the exact same. I'll just show you the reactor, I guess. Let's put the video. Let's see. Sorry about your face there, but. Reactor, can you see it?
Yes.
It's the same reactor that I built originally. I'm using the Flower of Life, same one. See, I had originally four here, four there, and I put the containment fields here, right? And there's another third star formation that will go outside here. That's Ali's reactor, isn't it?
I think so, pretty much. Looks, yeah, it seems to be the basic layout, other than perhaps the heights of the coils might be different and so on.
Well, my original one, I had three of them in a star formation here, and then three of them in another one upside down. But I laid them out flat because I'm pretty sure if I can get these nano coated, I'm coating some that, getting some. Can you see this? I got a zinc and the copper coil in a plastic bag. I don't know if I'm going to get copper oxide out of that or not. But when I power this, it should position itself if I put a sink. But here's what I'm really showing you. You see the flower of life there, right? Those are the field line interactions. You see how the field comes out of here, goes around, connects to this one. That one goes around and connects to that one. This is a schematic of the plasma field interactions. This is a coil that's. Instead of putting a single coil around it there, just put two coils. This is the same blueprint I used in July.
You gotta freeze for a minute. Hold back.
Yeah.
Okay, I'll show you something here.
Okay.
This is the frame for the original one. I scaled it up. That's the original one. It's using this one, that one, that one, that one. This is slightly larger, so it doesn't fit. That's the reactor I built in July. That is the same as
You have to hold the camera steady, otherwise all we get is a blurry image, Muriel.
okay. You see now?
Yes, it starts to clarify once you hold it steady. That's way better. Okay, we can see the lines
Same
there and so
reactor.
on.
Same reactor. This reactor, I achieved flight. But I didn't let or but I didn't video it, lift it up and smash into pieces. I had some of these lifting up and flying out. One of those flew out the window. This is like 6 months ago.
What do
This
you
is, you see, I'm saying the information here, it can't be a coincidence. I designed the last 2 weeks ago. The blueprints for the spaceship came out. It's this. I made it in July.
Yeah, you gotta freeze. Hold it. Hold right there. That's good.
See the plasma field schematic? See, I've been trying to show you this, well, for weeks. I actually said I had a schematic of the plasma fields. You were all talking about it, and nobody seemed interested. I promise you, I know how to tune this to any field strength. This is set to the fifth mode. This one is set to the first mode, the original one. That means that's the atomic structure. This is the solar system. I know how to tune this. I can show you with this why I knew September, the periodic table of elements, is backwards. I showed it to Max and those guys. I can show you how a lot of things about human perception that I learned from this. This is the reactor I built in July, only now I'm using just copper and no plastic. The plastic has to be nano-coated. I've been nano-coating plastic since July, and if you have it nano-coated correctly, you could torch it and it won't melt. Well, this was nano-coated 4 or 5 times. I had a reactor in it. Look at it. Still melted from just the caustic. You know, the Faraday experiment, I was trying to put a sun in it. Just the frame just melted. You see, this information I have is correct. No question about it. See, instead of following the golden ratios, and I can show you with this, mathematics is a fool's errand. These rings, where these rings are, right here, if you go out and you put a guitar string across the center here from the out to the out, this is where the overtones are on your guitar string. It's what they call Pythagorean tuning. This is where, if that's an A, that's a G, that's an F. These are musical notes. Everything in the universe has a frequency. It's not a metaphor. See what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
I designed a spaceship reactor in July based on this. Ali was saying, look how much it looks like the Serral engine. I showed you this drawing last May, and I said it's the Serral engine. This is actually more sophisticated than this one, but it has plastic. I was thinking about using this, 4 of these for the last star formation, but it has plastic. But this, I had 120 milliliters in there. These could hold double that. I doubt there's maybe the coils, but they're not really, those are conduits. The amount of GANs I have on this reactor won't be more than I had on this one, probably. This is a powerful flight reactor. Well, this is, the ones are in Shanghai. I left them in China, but this information is not coincidental. And I've been sitting on this for how many months and months and months. I'd have built this in January. Well, of course, I'd have used plastic at that time, but my boxes didn't arrive. Sat in for 3 weeks, and the boxes arrived the day before I went back to China for 3 weeks. So I got back last week. Using this is better. See, what happened when I lost this reactor, it went flying out the window. These were all nano-coated together. How many times? 10, 15 times. I could never get another one balanced at the end of the reactor. At least with these, you can fire them and you put different GANs on them. It'll single firing nano coating. You can replace them. It'll always have a different character, but it's replaceable. So anyway, I don't know. What do you think?
Well, I know you've been haranguing us about this for a long time. It's true. And you've had this design, like you say, last year before this reactor combination was even finalized and so on. And yeah, I agree. The the field lines seem to be crossing at the points where you know, harmonics would be indicated and so on. It absolutely makes sense. And of course, that's the way the universe works, as which is by, you know, vibration and harmonics and that kind of thing, generally speaking, is the way the universe works. So it would make perfect sense that the scale or the...
actually the Greeks call it
the mode.
Each mode, right? The Dorian mode, Ionian mode, Dorian mode, Phrygian mode. That's what these are. And I think Mr. Keshe said this in the kids' workshop. The universe has atomic structures. So if I put a coil here as the central core, then this is the A, this is the G, F, E, D, C, B, out to the octave. These are all different sizes, like half steps and whole steps. If I put a coil here and I call that A, then this is A, this is G, this is F, and it's the same thing.
But you're off screen a little bit, Mario.
Yeah, I'm sort of standing here.
There you go. That's good. Thanks.
If you put the coil here, that's A. You get an arrangement of whole and half steps that gives you certain harmonic chord progressions. If you put the coil here, you get, it's the same ratios, but you go out one more, that's A, and that's, now it's a different arrangement of whole and half steps. It's a completely different combination of harmonies. See what I mean? So this is the atomic. Mr. Keshe said next is the molecular, next is the chemical, next is the biological, and that's as far as he went. I'm thinking this is either the Earth or the solar system, probably the solar system. So that's where I have this. So this is the A, that's the B, the G, that's the F, and I gotta go way out. There's a way to reduce this into one octave to make the whole thing smaller, so you can still make it bigger or smaller, but I just use this drawing.
That's See, how you I, that's how you determine when you looked at, you put your flower of life here, you determined the size of your magnetical coil by how it crossed the intersections of your drawing on your
exactly. See it right there. You see it underneath it, right?
Yes.
So I sent the core there, and then these are where the field lines are crossing. This drawing is really not that accurate. It's close enough. See, I can tune this. And Nicholas is the one who said you can plot the periodic table of elements and you can plot the solar system. Well, if that's true, you should be able to plot anything. And with some help, I know how to put the periodic table of elements on there. This one is already set for that, but I can't really coil this. Too small. I have to scale it up. But I know how. See, I can tune, I can plot, tune, and replicate any field in the universe.
How do you think it'll go as far as the more three-dimensional aspect? How do you think it'll go as far as a more three-dimensional aspect? For example, the coils. One coil may be lifted over the other and so on as the current incarnation. Position themselves.
They will position themselves. Once I think I have to put a sink. I was just watching. I did not watch it last night. I think Mr. Keshe explained it again. Watching last night's, well, for me, it's last night's international workshop. Came on later and I didn't know it was on. So, I had these, this one first, lifting up and flying out. I never got it on video because I'd be like, wow, what's that doing way up there? Volt would be gone. Most of the time, I heard it. I'd be, swing, bing, what the heck is that? Look, I put tape underneath there. You can see it. I had to put some tape underneath there so that it could lift up. And it would lift up and stay there. And then this one started flying out. This is the one that just went out the window. The whole reactor lifted once, smashed into pieces. I mean, I wasn't like, eureka, I got lift. I was like, wow, what a catastrophe, you know? I mean it, and it certainly was a controlled flight, that's for sure, you know? So, I mean, whatever, but, and, you know, at the time, I was like, I didn't really know what was going on. Later, Mrs. Keshe was saying, you want to have your spaceship, you put your three reactors here, and this one will position itself up. Explaining that last, I don't know, October or November, I went, oh, that's what was happening. So that happened in October when it smashed. I got the frame still here because if I have nano-coated plastic, I'm keeping it. But the thing again, as soon as one of these frames broke, as soon as I put some hot glue together, I'm back to square one because the hot glue is plastic that's not been nano-coated. See what I mean? So it's a problem, man, with the plastic. So I'll put four more eggs, and I have to hang one somehow. I'm not ready to put a hook in my ceiling just yet. So anyway, I know what I have is viable. The information is correct. I could show you with these drawings how mathematics, you know, I have two books here, The History of the Nature of Musical Tones, going back to Pythagoras and Boethius. There's more. You know, this book, I can show you how you can never use mathematics, ever. Mr. Price has said that, but I can show you why. You can never use mathematics as absolute values. You can only use ratios.
So you know, when are you going to do that, Mario? This is Denny.
You know, I've been here for a month, and you know, I said I had the information, but at least now you see I have validation. It's like every week I get more and more validation. In December, I know what I got, but more validation. And then 10 days ago or whatever, when the Starship reactor came out, all he was saying, look how much it looked like the Cerel engine, which is exactly what I was saying in May. The drawing, you know, that's the Cerel engine. That's the flight reactor. Mr. Keshe said, right idea, wrong fuel. So I built an upgraded one. This is more powerful than that until it positions itself, because I already got it in position. But those coils are going to start rotating and they'll position themselves. But Mr. Keshe said, leave them wired because you're liable to have one of them fly out the window like I had, you know? So I'm not sure how to hook them up, how to connect them. Some of my eggs, I coiled as much coil as anybody, I'm pretty sure. I mean, I've been coiled. You would not believe how many configurations I had of coils. I got a couple of them here. I show you this one. The fellow from Singapore had one like this. See, this one fits in this frame. This was too big, the other frame. See, I had the three base reactors, then this one, and then I had the three base reactors and that one, and it just barely fits. I have to keep increasing the amount of turns. And then I got to there and it fit in the frame. I was like, wow, great. And then I looked, how much wire do I got left? About a meter. I needed about 20 more meters. You see, this is 20 meters. Well, here. So I ran that. When that happened, I was like, there's got to be an easier way to coil these, you know? And then the stacker units came out. I went, wow, you can connect them at the tails. Didn't know you could do that.
Could you hold that up to the camera again, please?
Yeah, sure.
This is the guy from Singapore.
Oh, hey, man. How you doing?
I'm good.
Yeah, but I have to have three of them. You know, not one. Let's see if I got this right here. Yeah, there'd be the three base reactors. And there's that one, and it fit up. That's why I made this frame lattice. This is 10% larger, so this doesn't fit in there very well, but it fit. It fit. Yeah, there's a top reactor. But I got to have another one. Got to coil around like this. There's your three base reactors. There's your top reactor upside down. And then I have to have three more. And one up on top ran out of wire. I was like, oh man, can't believe it. Spent, I don't know how many, 2 days building this.
It's actually very nice to see the evolution of that single flower of life design. Thank you so much.
Yeah, it is pretty cool. I think I was hung up on the flower of life. Leonard came up with some spiraling coils. My ideas were always really some version or other of this. That's why when I saw, just put a single band around it. That's all you really need. Don't have to actually replicate the flower, so to speak, you know? And there's so many of these versions of these, you know? But I had one spiraling, but you got to go in two directions. To try to start with 100 meters of wire, start in the middle, and coil in two directions at the same time. It's like, holy crap. Got to be an easier way, you know? And there is. There is. So thank God for Mr. Cash, you know, showing an easier way to do that. But this is the same reactor as that.
Mario, can I jump in here for a sec?
Yeah.
Just to offer you a little insight that came out of Peru. A friend of mine, I taught how to build a reactor down in Peru, and they were concerned about the case for their reactor. And I suggested, go out in the bush, find materials. They've got this bamboo-like stuff, and they've got some like really nice woods. And he made his case out of wood. He has a charcoal retort that he makes biochar with. And while this thing was running, the heat coming off of it is intense. So he took his wooden frame, and he nano-coated it over top of the biochar retort. Wow. He was getting phenomenal results with his reactor. I think if you were to rebuild that frame in wood and nano-coat it with fire, you're going to solve a whole bunch of your problems.
Well, you know, that's a really good idea. And I could probably buy bamboo in Thailand. China is easier, but I'm sure they got it. It's pretty easy to get bamboo. But I really decided that I don't think I need to replicate the star formation. I think I can do what Ali's done, what Marco did. If Marco can do it that way, it should be okay, the way I laid it out, where these are just flat, and then the position themselves, I think, is...
Yeah, well, what I was thinking was, is you've already mentioned, you've got the device in your hand, we already know it works. It's already flown, it's already positioned itself. The only problem is it's plastic.
Yeah.
So if we could recreate that out of natural materials.
That's true. You still got a problem with these guys. Gotta coat those. But the eggs, the eggs, it's the only thing I didn't coil. And these eggs, I might have to redo every one of them because they're pretty terrible. I never saw them as a conduit, so I never replicated it. It's a reactor instead. I think this is too small anyway, because no matter what, I have to put a conduit around there. And it has to be, this is only a magnetical field. There's no gravitational coil inside it. And I have to have a really tiny diameter to get inside there. That will barely fit in the frame. Too small. It'll fit if I only have a magnetical coil. But if I have to have a magnetical and a gravitational, I have to make this a lot bigger. I scale it. I can still keep it to the atomic level or whatever level I want. But I think that at the worst case, might try actually taking this, maybe getting bamboo and placing them in the star formation. But just another question I'm not really sure about. Oh, and I have some, I need to show you my fire burning technique. I don't know what I did here, why it looks like it does. I want to show you, maybe you can help me out with that. Maybe using bamboo would be a way to position them, but there are six coils around the center coil. I did that because Marco did it. I originally had four. And, you know, it's where the field lines cross. They actually intersect and cross where there's a free plasma would form, every other one. And they, none of those six coils are connected directly to each other by the field lines. Connected in between, which is interesting. So assuming you have six of them, you'll get 12 of them, six of them as free plasmas. And then the outer one, you have 12. So how do you put those six into a star formation? See what I mean? And if Marco did it with six, I'm copying Marco. You know what I mean? It seems to me, I mean, it's the same thing at the end of the day, and I'm just not sure how would they position themselves. You don't really have one star formation there. You know what I mean?
Hey, Mario, this is Denny. How would you like to do it? I mean, you know how Marco would do it, but how would you like to do it?
Well, it's the same reactor. It's the same reactor. There's no difference. What I want to do is plot the periodic table of elements on it. I want to get a flower of life drawn out where you have the elements on it. And then tune whatever you want. See, with the adjustable outside star formation.
When you say tune, what do you mean by that? Because, you know, I'm not, you guys.
Every one of those coils there and every one of those reactors is placed in a position where relative to the central core, if you call that the tonic note of your scale, then all of those others are placed in positions where the harmonic overtones ring out and give you a note. That's why you have an element there. That's why you have the earth there, because there's field lines crossing, see? So basically, you lay out the arrangement so that you play three notes. That's the difference is those, you play the chord. If I plot calcium as a B flat.
Can you show me by going over there and pointing on your drawing what you mean?
Actually, I could show you the drawing here. It's probably easier.
Okay.
Let me see if I could share a screen. I'll find this drawing. Okay. Yeah, well, here it is. Okay, let me share a screen here. If that's okay, yeah? Share screen. Okay. Okay, you can see this? Okay, this would be the central core. If you call this size, the way this is drawn out, this would be the note A. These are the note B, but or G rather. They're getting bigger. It's like a bigger bell inside of a bigger bell. The frequencies get weaker as you go out, right? So if you call this A, then these are Gs, really from a G flat up to a G sharp. So something will be plotted somewhere here, right on the dot or somewhere in here. You know what frequency it is. So you put a coil around it here, you put a reactor, either six of them, and you put another coil there, and then you have to put two more notes that'll spell, what do you want, a G flat chord. So I put a G flat, a B flat, and a D flat. Those three notes will give me a three chamber reactor with three different Ganses, so they have a gradient and a stable harmonic structure, a stable plasma structure. When you, in music, in physics, in plasma, whenever these two field lines cross, the difference of those frequencies, it's like the two field lines balance each other out, and whatever's left over is equal to the mass. Its mass tunes to a note. These, if it's here, it's a G. Or actually, it'd be a G flat. If it's here, it's a G. If it's here, it's a G sharp, and then you get to the A's. So you can literally tune to whatever frequency is. You say this, you know, you have whatever, gold, turns out to be there. What note is that? Okay, so I put my containment field there, and then I put a ring of plasmas there, either six of them, and I have to contain them a certain size from the there, so I get the measurements from here. I play whatever chord that is, to B flat. Play a B flat chord. It'll ring out as a gold field. Now, you see what I mean? So anything that can be plotted on there, if you plot it as a musical note, you can replicate the notes by playing the chord. That's what that reactor is there. It's got two containment fields, but it's actually going to have three rings of plasma. So you have three note chord. You really only need two notes as an interval to get the same thing. But I guess it depends on what you want to do. If you want to get calcium, you could probably just use two notes. If you want to have the hull of your spaceship, probably want to have a more stable field. It's that kind of thing. Does that make sense? No.
What would you choose?
No, I mean, a three note chord is considered the basis of our harmony. Two notes is not considered stable enough to be a harmonic entity on its own, even though it is. The trinity, the trilogy, the three layers of the skin, having three gradients, something about that, the trinity, you know, like a triangulation, you know, a three-sided stand you can put anywhere. Four legs, it's out of balance, but you can find balance with three legs in any environment. That's why they use three tripods for cameras and such. See what I mean? No, a chord is, we have intervals, and then anything that's considered a chord has to have at least three notes. Yeah, that right. Now you can have four note chords, but basically a four note chord is the triad plus another note. That's how you think of it. It's a seventh chord. Okay, you have the root, third, and fifth. There's your triad, you add the seventh. If you take those triad notes out, you don't have a seventh chord. You got some other chord again, see? So yes, you can make three, four, five note chords, but at the end of the day, you subtract every frequency from every other frequency, the primary ones, and then when you get those sums, you subtract those from each other until you get down to one frequency. That'll be a largest bell, because it's an octave lower, it's the lowest frequency. It's counterintuitive, but the weaker the strength, the larger the field, which is what Mr. Keshe said, that you go in to get stronger fields, right? So the larger field is the weaker field. It'll be a single pitch as a single entity. So the one I made, even though I couldn't tune it, it's still tuned to a chord. I just don't know what chord it is, because I don't know how big the ganses are, how big these individual fields are. You know what I mean? So, and you see, that makes sense. But with containment coils, if I can get the periodic table of elements correctly laid on this, and you know, like I said, always you subtract the frequencies to get a new entity. Whatever the total or the difference of them is, the new entity that's created. That's why I showed this to Max and those guys. Why does Mr. Keshe add atomic weights when he's using the periodic table of elements? When it's the difference of the field strengths. See what I mean? I showed that to Max and those guys. Periodic table of elements is upside down. That makes sense? I wouldn't even have said that because you'd have thought it was crazy, but Mr. Keshe said it last week. But I told it to Max and those guys last September. Mr. Keshe said the periodic table of elements is upside down. You have to put that spiral from the outside in. I said I found the spiral, but it had to be calibrated. I just kind of left it at that because you kind of, well, anyway, you wouldn't believe me anyway. So I know how to plot, measure, and replicate any.
Well, right now, Mario, I'm as dumb as a stump. Yeah, well, yeah, it doesn't make much difference if you're dumb as a stump. You can start from where you think you might be. So what he's got here is the flower of life, and he's explaining things so excitedly because he's really excited about his knowledge.
Hello. Hey, everybody.
A I guess we lost Mario's drawing. So I can't quite. Hi, Mario. Here you are.
Lost you, Mario.
My computer's unstable, internet, but I'm not saying nothing. Look at me. Look, I nano-coded this with fire. I don't know if you can see it. It's rainbow-colored. It's not really black. Is it nano-coded? This is one of my Faraday cages that failed.
Yeah, not quite enough heat, and it cooled too quickly.
Say it again? What?
Not quite enough heat, and it cooled too quickly.
Ah. Now, I did some eggs, and I got sort of the same problem. What do I have to do? Go around and around and around in one direction all the way? Because I got a lot of coils to nanocode.
I think it was Vernie who described it with the torch. You heat it up to the point where the copper turns shiny. It turns into a shiny gold-like color at one point. And after that, the black will form on it quite rapidly.
As soon as it gets like that color, is that it?
As soon as it gets to that sort of bronze or brassy color, sort of a bright color is a good way to put it. Just before it turns to red hot, it'll turn to that color. And you don't want it to go to the red hot point, yeah. Only to that color, which shortly after that it'll turn black by itself. So it'd be a little trickier with multiple coils and so on to get the inside and the outside to the right temperature and all that. As mentioned by John, you might get spotty places, depending if it was cold in the environment and the item was cold to start with, then it's more to heat up. So we might try preheating in an oven or preheating the whole thing with a torch first. Using a.
It's pretty hot, so I think it's okay.
Yeah.
Another thing to keep in mind is the shape of your flame. If you go just down to Home Hardware or wherever and buy a torch, typically you'll get what's called a tiger torch, and the flame comes out kind of a ragged, spread out, ugly flame. But if you can get the old style propane torches with the pencil tip on them, you'll have much better success at controlling your heat.
Well, the only torch I could find, here, I looked around. I could not find it in China, and I found this on the guy selling cigarette lighters.
Yeah, that's a pencil torch. That'll give you a nice heat, but you need to turn it up.
Where do I put it? You see there's like the red there and the blue there. Where do I put it? Where the blue is?
Well, you've got two blues. You've got the bright blue little skinny one in the center, and then you've got a very, very dim blue one around the outside of that. It extends about an inch past that. You want to be just on the tip of that really light, like the dim blue.
So where do I want to put it, like there? That close?
No. Just at the tip of the flame. If you turn it on and look at the flame, you'll see a bright blue, and surrounding the bright blue, there's a very dim blue.
I'm inside here with the aircon. I don't want to turn this on too much.
You'll need a dark background to see it. But there'll be a really light blue, little skinny little pencil tip inside, and around that will be a darker blue, very, very difficult to see. But you want just on the tip of that darker blue.
Okay.
That's where your maximum heat's going to be.
Okay. Man, I'm gonna have to practice.
It's an art. It's like music. It's something that you just have to work at until you get it. And once you get it, you wonder why you didn't get it before.
But it seems like every time I get something down, I'm doing this. Can you see it? I've got one of my coils there, and I got a zinc coil there, and I just took that apart. Shoot, I'm at the Tesla motor that just came loose. So shoot, I shouldn't have.
Okay.
But that's, I guess, I don't know if it's going to work laying down like that.
Are you trying to make CO2 in a bag?
Yeah.
Yeah, you need to be able to adjust that, the spacing between them very, very accurately. because that when you're doing it dry like that, the spacing is absolutely critical.
I know. You know, I have two of these guys that they ordered from me, the Max, those guys. Using that, I was able to, I have to fix that now. With the electrolysis, man, I got really good at getting GANSes. And you can see, you can measure, you can see you set it for 1.5 volts, and you can see how many watts you're getting by how close the plates are, so you can actually position the plates. My experience is that they needed to be really close, so I tried laying it down like that. I only did it this morning, and so getting GANSes this way, it's going to take me a week, maybe 10 days, if it works. I don't know if it's laying it down like that. I mean, have you guys tried it yet, doing that?
I don't think the orientation is really going to matter, but I do know the spacing, the distance between your two systems is going to be critical. And looking at your system, because you're using a cylindrical field for your nano coating, it's like trying to tune a really fat string to a really specific
tip. Yeah, I know. Thought about that. I'm nano coating some plates right now. I'll put a plate on there. I'm going to try some other things, but I don't know how to test it. With the electrolysis, I can just look and see the connection, you know, but with this, I guess it's trial and error, and it's going to could take me a month or something. So I'll let you know what goes on with that. So, I know the spacing. I found I needed to keep the plates really close together, but not this close, maybe, but I don't know how else to do it, you know?
Okay. Back to your egg coils with your heat coating your egg coils. Yeah. If you were to hang them on a single piece of wire that you can spin in your fingers, and spin it in front of the flame. Instead of trying to move the flame around it, hold the flame steady and spin the coil.
So I have it hanging some way that I can spin it around that way, right?
Just have a straight piece of wire that you can spin like a top between your thumb and your finger.
Oh, right. Okay. Yeah. I was wondering about that, trying to walk around the coil and stuff. It's not really working.
Too much work. Spin the coil.
Yeah. All right. Thank you, man. Thank you.
Yeah, no worries.
Actually, is this John?
Am I talking to you? Yes, it is.
I really appreciate your videos, man. I learned a lot from those, man. Yeah, you could do as many more of those as you want, man. Anyway.
My expertise is in the mechanical aspect. I'm a tool and die maker by trade. And I watch people struggle with the mechanical stuff so much, and it's so easy once you get it. I have to teach them how to do it, and once they get it, they run with it and go crazy.
Yeah, well, I kind of got it. I didn't run with it that well, but I'm working on it, and I'm the worst mechanical thing ever, man. But anyway, but I'm persistent, so. But before I go coil those, and I don't know, like this egg, is it seem okay to you? Or, I mean, it should be okay.
In my world, neatness counts, so... No. If I was to build that egg, I'd sit there with watching a movie or something and work on it until it's perfect. But that's just me. Now, whether it actually matters, I think it would in a very detailed sense, because you know, like as you noticed with your Flower of Life drawings and your interactions, if one of those reactors is out a little bit, your harmonic is gone. So if one of the fields within that egg is offset slightly, the harmonic of the egg is gone, correct?
Well, I don't know if that's the case, but definitely it could definitely disrupt the field. I think it probably wouldn't, you can't change the key. What you just do is don't get a field connection. Yeah. Don't get this.
Yeah, there's a little tool you can get or even build. It's really easy to do. Two plates with a hole in it that are spaced just the width of the wire, and you slip your wire through a pin that goes through the hole in the center and twist that pin. And it twists those coils up perfect. And then it's just a matter of taking your thumbs and pushing them into an egg shape.
Oh, I see.
There's a Golden Age of GANS. There's a post on there showing that tool and drawings of how to make it. Super simple.
All right, cool. I'll look that up. Yeah. All right, thank you. Appreciate it. Okay, well, that's what I got. Anyway.
Yeah, and there's another one. It's called a wig jig. That's that makes a spiral as well, and you can almost make a hybrid between the two.
Yeah, there's a, there's several different ways you can do it. The simplest one that I've seen is just a spool that's got a very narrow little slot in it. You stick the end of the wire in and you spin it around that spool. And it can't, the wire has to stay one on top of the other because of the narrowness of that spool. And then when you get however many winds you want, you take it out, open the spool up, take your coil off.
Do you then, to get your tail, John, what do you do on undo part of it? How do you get your extra tail?
If your center axle, either the part you're turning to make the coil or the axle of the spool itself, if it's hollow, you can just stuff your tail, your extra 3 inches of wire into the center of that axle.
Yeah, that's a pretty, I have one of those little tiny ones, and that was the thing that I had wrong with it, is that it wouldn't give me a big tail.
Yeah, Rick's wound a one there that's really nice and even.
Well, that's,
Rick, see, this you, is the way.
You spotlight that, Rick, because
right, good point. Thank you. There we go. Yeah, this is done in the technique that you're just talking about. With, I actually started out with two plexiglass plates, about yay big, with a hole in the center with the pin in the middle. And then I just wound the wire between the two plates, like a double wound wire between the two plates. And when you end up, what you end up with is this type of structure when you kind of squish these together. It looks sort of like that. And then it's easy to actually move the two wires sideways to make these into a 90 degree intersecting sort of cool coil antenna that I had at that time. This is 5 or 6 years ago. And the interesting thing is that, yeah, you can make it into a double egg-shaped coil the same way as John was talking about. You just basically pull out each of these coils into a, I could almost do it here by sort of bending it a certain way. You can see there's, it starts the egg shape there. And yeah, so the double plate method definitely works. It keeps the coils centered and so on. They kind of spring out to a nice even spacing once you coil it up. So that's a different technique.
Wire before you wind it, they won't spring nearly as bad either.
Yeah, that's right.
Just heat it up until it turns dark. Not black, but just the color changes to a darker copper. And at that point, it's dead soft. And you wind those coils up and they'll just stay wherever you want them to.
Yep, good hint there. What else have I got?
Yeah, I used to anneal brass by hand, like hundreds and hundreds of pieces a day. And I got really good at catching that color change just at the right point and throwing them in a bucket of water over and over 600 times a day for 3 days straight.
Yeah.
Really good at it after a while.
Alrighty. What else do we have to show and tell here for today's activities? Oh, in that same sense, let me grab this. It's the same deal with these kind of coils. If you were to use like this is copper quarter inch tubing, and it's the same deal that comes naturally.
That's an interesting looking still. Sure you want to show it on public TV?
Comes in a box like this, flat coil, and I'll just do a demonstration here so you can look. It's quite a nice way to go in a way. So that's the way, this is the way it comes from the Home Depot or plumbing store in the box, and then it's quite easy to just grab one end and gently pull it apart, and everything sort of self-centers, and then you can take two of those and put them together, and oops, this one didn't, it's not quite together, but you can join them. I've got a little plastic joiner. You can see there that the pipes can join together, and you can create structures with that that can enclose fields, or you can run fluids through the structure and that sort of thing. The idea being that it's quite simple to create these kind of structures while it's already flat in the box, and you just, you know, if you can design things that end up being simple without having to create the structures too much, then it can be useful. So it's a jack in the box, instant structure in a box. Be nice if we had we could transport our structures flat, and you get them and you just open them up and pop them open into their 3D shape, and you set it up and you've got your reactor ready to go.
Give it a whack like a top hat.
Yeah, that's a good idea. Flat for shipping. Pancake coil.
Yeah.
Okay, yes. Anyways, that's a little side note there, you might say.
Rick, I can show you
what else
this.
We got going.
Rick,
there's this an is interesting thing that Guy actually came up with last week, and I heard him playing around over there in the last Knowledge Seekers workshop, but I wasn't sure what he was up to. And I've shown these before, which are these eggies, they're called, and they're egg-shaped containers, and they've got a screw-off top here, and inside, in this one, I've got a ping-pong ball and some Gans water, and so the cap screws on, everything's sealed, it's got little O-rings, plastic O-rings, rubber O-rings. And this also comes apart here. I could take this part off, leaving the bottom part here, and the top part separate. And you, that way you can put an actual ping pong ball inside, or Gans, or whatever you want to do, and seal it up if you have a large object in there. So what Guy did was, he took this thing apart, and he put the double coil in there. So it's a really nice little arrangement. It just fits perfectly. And there's like no, it's a tight fit. There's no flop in there. And he made the coil before. He just happened to have that. And the eggy thing just happened to show up. And they both happen to fit perfectly. So it's kind of an interesting containment for the fields, you might say. And a place where you can have Gans or other liquids surrounding the nano-coated structure. Interesting, Guy, thanks for that idea. Might inspire someone to do something with it. Okay, what else we have? Any questions or comments, ideas?
Phone's back on, Rick.
I have a question.
Open to suggestion here.
Headphones.
Sorry.
Go ahead, Denny.
Hello.
Mario, sorry.
Oh, okay.
When you're talking about the Gans water,
so
you're
getting, I'm seeing. This because I don't have my headphones on, and I'm thinking I'm hearing everyone. So good for wandering around the room. Okay, sorry, I can hear you now. If you were desperately screaming for help. Pardon me?
The water you siphon off from the Gans, or do you mean Gans water that you treated with a banana or whatever on top? What do you mean?
Well, by Gans water, I would mean like if this was a container of Gans, then the Gans would settle to the bottom. In fact, you can actually see Gans at the bottom of this.
And
the water is what forms on top, yeah. And that would be the distilled water that's already been washing out the GANs maybe three or four times at that point. So it should be just the water, nothing but the water. That's the way I understand. If anybody thinks different, please speak up.
Don't use the water that you're washing your GANs with. Use the water after you've washed it three or four times and then put in fresh water, let it settle, and use that water off of there. You don't want any salt in there.
Right, exactly. Thanks for clarifying. And like, for example, Renan mentioned for his health pads, his patches, that he was he would have the, like in this example, the CO2 would be at the bottom of the container. If you can see there, there is some, so you can see it there at the bottom. And so he would fill the top of the container with water, let it settle, use the water on the top to fill his GANs, his pain patches, and just replenish the water with more water on the top, keep the same GANs in there. And he says he can just repeatedly do that process, putting the fresh water in. It gets charged by the GANs that's already in there, and you don't have to use up your GANs that way. You just use the same GANs. And he's gone through hundreds and hundreds of these pads by just replenishing the water. What an economical way to go. Literally less than a penny a pad to create these pain patches and so on. Quite amazing to hear these stories.
Down in Peru, he's got about a gallon of GANs, and I'm laughing at him constantly when I'm talking to him, because he's got so much GANs, he can feed the whole town for the rest of their lives, because he never has to use any of it up.
Yeah, that's a very interesting concept. The water takes the energy, the fields. It's like the information is imparted without the actual materials being imparted.
Yeah, just keep in mind, if anybody is going to do this, just keep in mind it doesn't last forever. The water will eventually neutralize itself, and that energy will be lost, which makes total sense, because otherwise all of the water on the planet is going to be totally charged up. And
right, a single drop of GANs would make all the oceans turn into GANs mush or something.
Exactly. So what we're thinking, we haven't done the experiment yet, but we believe that if you want to reset your water, just leave it in the sun.
Oh. Like, and you mean the actual pad could be left in the sun?
Well, if you left the pad in the sun, it's going to be a wet paper towel. Because that broad spectrum energy is going to go in there and just neutralize any specific energies that are in that pad. That's the theory. We don't know. We haven't tested it yet. But there has to be some natural way to reset that energy in the water. And
reset by the GANs when it passes close to the GANs, or you mean the GANs water itself loses its energy over time, like over use, let's say?
I don't know if use will use it there, but I do believe that over time your pads are going to get weaker and weaker and weaker until they're eventually just wet paper towels in a baggie.
Right. Well, that does make sense. Like if you had the water with the CO2 GANs or something, like in a health cup, for example, it should retain its potency because of the GANs would be there to constantly recharge the water, invigorate it with the fields, I understand.
Yeah, that's why in my health cup, I do have about half an inch of GANs, CO2 GANs in the bottom of the cup.
Right.
And it stays there. That way, that water, even if I'm out in the sunshine or walking around or playing with the dog or whatever, I've got my cup, I'm not going to lose that potency. But if you just use the water in your health cup, and if it does turn out to be sunshine that resets it, if you have your cup sitting on a windowsill for 2 hours, it's going to be useless.
Useless? Well, or would it get recharged? Wouldn't it get recharged?
Recharge it with a little bit of Gans or some fresh Gans water.
Found these in the dollar store here locally in Western Canada, which is pretty nice. It's got a cap like a normal cup, but it's nice having the liner. Fits right inside and just screws together. And so you can undo it, and it's just like the other normal health cups. You can remove that. I say you can remove that paper liner. And it's nice because the paper liner is the perfect template. It's got cute animals too that you can color. It's got a template for the for cutting out the copper plate or copper foil, whichever you use. And there is a straighten out there. There is a curve this way on that edge, and a curve this way on the bottom edge, and each side has a slight taper as well. It's subtle, but it makes a difference, so it fits in nice and neat and tidy once you cut to that exact shape. And Douglas had a nice tip for us about cutting the copper, especially if you have a plate, because you end up with rough edges where the scissors or shears were cutting it. And so what he does is he puts it down on a hard surface with a hammer and taps along the edge, and that peens over the edge and smooths it. And then he actually uses sandpaper to smooth out that edge so that each edge on his plate is completely smoothed over. So then when it's nano coated, it makes a nice even nano coating on the edges, which actually end up being important because you don't want any sharp edges, which could end up being a place where the copper comes through from the nano coating. It's important to have just nano coating on the plate all over without any bare copper edges, which in the solution could end up causing a copper CuO type Gans. It could create Gans inside that's the CuO Gans, and you may not want that in your health cup and so on. So it keeps things more pure when you have a pure, completely covered plate due to having smooth edges all the way around and no sharp things sticking out that might not nano coat as nicely.
Rick, what about using copper wire to wrap around the inner sleeve instead of using a plate? Would that be, I think that would be easier to work with, but would it be workable in the grand scheme of things?
Well, let me see. If you were to, whoops, that one didn't work out too well. You could wrap a wire around here, for example, and still fit it inside. But the idea is that I'm thinking of, you won't have anywhere near the surface area, first of all, and the fields of a full plate, I don't know, seems right for this cup somehow. Douglas was talking about it, and others have talked as well, like, for example, should you put a spiral coil or some other plate on the bottom of these cups with the plate inside? And the idea was, no, not such a good idea, because the fields, this cup will have an in and out to it. There'll be a field interaction going through the cup due to this both tapered and cylindrical plate that's inside. And it'll create a natural sort of vortex field effect through it. And if you were to put a plate on the bottom, it would block that complete field entry to exit sort of thing that's going on there. I'm thinking, and like perhaps wire would work, perhaps wire with the right spacing and so on would be correct to keep the plasmatic fields inside and so on. But I think that the plate, in this case, it just seems so natural to have a complete plate in there. And that seems to be what's been recommended for most people. Douglas seems to recommend the plate rather than the wire inside as well for that reason. Any other comments about that?
Yeah, I'd need to go out and buy some plate which is thinner and easier to work with. The plate that I have is too thick and it's quite difficult to cut.
Right, you can bend it easier by heating it and doing that whole process of annealing that John talked about earlier. That would be helpful there. But I got my copper plate, just a second here.
Yeah, there's also, if you look around, you can quite often find a very, very
fine. It's actually
fine
more of a foil. More of a foil than a plate. You can see it's it holds its shape pretty good, but it's quite floppy.
Yeah, that would be very easy to work with.
Yeah, scissors cut it easy, and you can get the wrinkles out easy by just, I run it along the edge of my desk and so on to sort of smooth it out in different places. You can smooth it out that way. So yeah, it's easy to work with. I got this at what's called the Metal Supermarket, and they're a chain of metal stores across Canada, possibly in the U.S. too. And it comes on a big roll, about yay wide. They have it had it right at the front of the shop, like it was a popular item. And I believe they call it copper shim stock. It's a special thickness of the copper that's easy to work with to make shims out of and so on. You can make gas, copper gaskets and that sort of thing.
Did you, Rick, did you see a manufacturer's name on your container?
On this container? Okay. Yeah.
I don't know if you, I mean, it came from like a dollar store, didn't it? So yeah. You probably don't get a manufacturer's name with it.
It's of course made in China. It's called Travel Mug. Travel Mug, imported by in the U.S. by Greenbrier International Inc. In Canada from DTSC Imports from Burnaby, BC. So that's DTSC Imports, Burnaby, BC. V5G4P3. That was the Canadian one. The other one being a Greenbrier International Inc.
Yeah, I didn't find that in my my dollar stores.
Oh yeah. Okay. And well, this was a new edition. I'd never seen these before until last week, and they were in the ordinary cup area. As opposed to a special aisle of the place, which I've seen these before, similar.
Well, what was your price on that?
$125, pretty hard to beat.
That's very hard to beat. I ended up paying something like $4 or $5 for mine, and I had to buy them from a company called Save a Cup out of California. Mine's a little bit different. And because the threads are at the bottom of the cup.
The bottom of the cup, yes, right.
Instead of at the top.
Yeah, I like the top idea. That way this is all sealed in its natural way. There's no chance of leak around the bottom and that sort of thing.
I mean, the insert threads, you would think it would be near the top like yours are, but they're near the bottom. If you want, I can show it on my...
Sure, might as well while we're on the topic.
And I also wanted to show my jig that I was making for turning coils in spirals.
All right.
So I spotlight it myself over you.
I got okay, you.
There's my face. Okay.
Gotta do it again, Rick.
Okay, there we go. Let me see here. I'll see if I can. So this right here was just a cap to a sewer cap, and I cut the this bottom off. I was just wondering if I had it sitting here, and this is just a wooden wheel, and so it's a little hole right next to the prong that comes out, and the prong is a quarter inch all thread. And so if you want to see your coil when you're doing it, then you can tighten it down with a nut on there. It's very similar to what John was talking about.
It's also similar to the one that I made myself. Mm-hmm.
And so you want the same width as the wire that goes in there. Now, the one that John's talking about also would have so that this would not be centered, but the fast, whoops, excuse me, it would have nuts and pin right here so that it would be very straight, and you would feed it in through the crack, and you would spin either the shaft, which in this case the shaft is also the wheel that I have, and this little tail here sits into a couple holes to hold it right. And so I was thinking of making bigger, so I would cut this cap down like this. And I want to be able to see, like this one is, I want to see my coils. So I would probably cut a groove in this too, so that I, like a window, so that I could see how many coils I had going, because I can't see through this. And
it would be stronger, Denny, if you took a spade drill, like a 3/4-inch spade drill, and poked 6 holes through that cap around the circumference. Oh, we lost you.
Denny, you're muted.
We lost you, Denny. Lost your audio.
Going back on now. There I am. Like what you said, John, I would also do that. I don't know if I need 6 or 3, but I would do it around the outside edge. This is a smaller one, and so I could, you know, just have it here and here and here, and the pins would be in here. I would screw them into there. But for the larger one, you know, you could just put them on the outside. And of course, that would hold it. It would hold it flatter. That's the whole purpose of it, is holding it flatter right up against the wire, so the wire can't move on you. It's going to have to be forced into a spiral. And so if you have it with just the nut, you might get a walk on you a little bit. It might tilt or something with the nut. So you may want to fasten it, like John said, in with the more fasteners.
Yeah, that's what I found exactly. I ran into that same issue.
And I have a problem with this one here because I didn't put my hole close enough to my peg. It sits out too far, so back here I have a T-nut on it, see. Mm-hmm. I put my hole next to my T-nut. I probably will next time just drill right close in there. It's just for my wire. It can be drilled on an angle, just as long as it comes, it's really close to this pin, so mm-hmm. you can get that wire down in there a little bit better. Otherwise, there's a it doesn't quite work smooth enough. Now, John says it would be nice to have a hollow tube in there, so when you fit the wire down there, it would just go right down the center of that tube.
Well, and what I'm seeing with your design, when you make your first loop of the coil, it's not going to be round. It's going to be egg-shaped.
Yeah, well, that's why I said it's got to be right near that this hole has to be right near the peg, or it has to go right down inside the peg.
Yeah, so the other option that you could solve that problem with would be to use a small washer that extends out to the outside edge of your hole for your wire, and then put a groove in that washer.
Yeah.
So that the first time you make the loop, it's perfectly round around the outside, and you don't have that little 90-degree bend in your wire pushing your profile out of shape.
Let run that by me again so that I can understand it. It's just like a lock washer that you've cut a groove in it. Is that what you're saying?
Essentially, yes. It's just a spacer that the diameter of the spacer extends out just to the outside edge of the hole that you use to hold your wire to anchor your wire. On that one, it looks like it's about about 3/8 of an inch from the center of that rod, right?
Well, it could be that. It could be just about It could be about a quarter to 3/8.
Okay, so you're looking at somewhere between 1/2 and 5/8 diameter spacer, the thickness of your wire, with a notch cut in it. So the wire, when it goes through that hole, parallel with your axle, it doesn't interfere with the first wind.
I think what I'll do, John, is I'll bring a hole a lot closer to the pen, and then I might gouge it in a little. I might just put a little groove so that it goes in there. I don't have to see this hole's out here, but I could drill another one over here on the other side.
Yeah. But and, if the hole is next to your axle, without a form around the outside of that hole, you're always going to wind up with an egg-shaped coil.
Do you think if I groove the black a little bit and put the wire in that groove?
You could take the axle out, take a Dremel, and cut a groove in your axle.
Yeah, that would do it.
Yeah.
Because this basically is the is what spins it, and it would be fairly fast, because what I was trying to do is if I was going to do it fast, I was going to just put a crank on this or a drill on it and just spin it, and I'd be up to snuff in a few seconds. But this right here, the size of this was because I was going to make larger star reactors. I was going to make larger star reactors compared to the smaller egg reactors that go on lay on the surface, I should say.
Yeah. And so, you know, that's a nice system, because you can tailor it for whatever size wire you want.
Right. See, this is 4 inches. This is 4 inches.
Yeah. You can wind 20 gauge or 4 gauge on that.
I was thinking that if I was to go as far as doing the nines, I would go as far as 45. That would be 22 and 23. I'd get 45. And then I would use two different sizes of gauges. I like use 20, and then I would use, I would use 12. And I lost myself here. That's all right.
No, Sikander just screen shared on us.
That's okay. I'm done with this. And I'll guess, can you put me back on just for a second, Sikander? Okay, so see, that's where this one screws on. It screws on down at the bottom of the container. Where yours screws on at the top, mine screws on down there. And And that's what it works. In fact, if you wanted to isolate something in that little spot down there, you could. You could make a special GANS that you put in there, and then you, I mean, since it's there, sure. And so that's, and then of course this then screws back on up. I got to get back into where I'm doing it. This screws back on up here. If I get my threads straight. And so that's that. And thanks, John, for the tip, because I was going to work this over a little bit so that it worked fast and smooth. But now this thing here, of course, you can get it in white too if you like white. But this was a little bit cheaper, and it's a cap, and it cost me about $7. I think a little more than seven, in between seven and eight, $7.71 or something like that. Yeah. So it's cheaper than acrylic, but what's so nice about acrylic, you can see through it, and that's why I need some kind of a window in this. I'd like to have a little groove for a window that I could see through and know how many coils I have inside. So I would just wanted to share that, because it looks like it's a clobber shoe, but it moves fairly easy, especially when I have it on its rack and it goes through this, the shaft goes through the rack, then it floats pretty easy. It spins fairly fast just by itself like a treadle. I was going to also try to put a crank on this, but I don't need to because of the weight of this wheel. That's it for me. I was right just on, going to share that because Mario wanted to know if you could how you get those coils nice and even, and a jig that a wig jig, and this right here is a variation of the wig jig, and I don't know where I have that other little jig that you were talking about, John, but I bought one of those, but it doesn't go very large.
It's for jewelry. You can get them off eBay. If you just look for spiral jig on eBay, you'll find them. But they're for very, very fine wire.
Yeah, they're for earrings and jewelry. Okay, that's it for me, you guys. I'll catch
you
later.
Thank you, Denny. Appreciate that.
Okay. Rick.
You're a gentleman and a scholar, Denny.
What?
You're a gentleman and a scholar, Denny.
Okay, well, thank you very much, you guys. I feel as dumb as a stump when Mario starts talking about that stuff. I need to go through it pretty slow. So, he's on to stuff. He's on to it, and it'd be great to be able to know what kind of material you're going to make when you start to make your ship, and being able to control it and tune it. And that would be what Mario's got going there, is something that I would think that I'd need to study out and do it slow enough so I could understand it.
Well, yeah, myself as well, but I think he's definitely onto something. Go ahead. Is that Doug?
I was going to say, I feel the same way when you just described that jig. I don't get it. I need help with that. But I'd be really happy to show you or share with any of you guys.
Doug's showing a picture. I don't really want to... I don't want to broadcast that though, Doug. It's a copyrighted picture, so I get in trouble and stuff like that.
Copyright stuff. About getting Boss in to talk about his reactor experience.
Yeah, let's do that then.
Yeah, Boss, you wanna come in and say hi and let us know. Maybe there's a bunch of people that don't know your story, so maybe we can get you to go through your story.
Yeah, sure. Can you hear me? First thing?
Yeah. No? Yep. Do you want to show your video or something? Or?
Yeah, I tried to do it. Let's see.
Great. It's coming through. Let me spotlight it. Yeah. There we go. Perfect. Great. Thank you.
Okay. I can tell you a little bit about... I've been doing some testing on a MagRav device that I bought from Keshe Foundation. And I had it beginning of January. So I've been running like 6-7 weeks now. And my average gain has been 7%. That's the energy I have gained on using the unit so far.
Yeah, we should let everybody know that Bossy's unit's on a really simple electrical system.
Yeah, it's a very controlled thing because I have a little cottage and I know exactly what the load I have, and it's permanent load and stuff like that. So
yeah, you know, there's not a lot of wire in his cottage. So
no, it's not. But and, anyway, I was pretty happy yesterday because I had my electric bill, and the electric bill, because I have been doing the whole of February, I have been loading with 500 watts. So I know exactly what load I have had on it, on the system. And when I compared to my electric bill, it was near 20%. So that was pretty nice.
Excellent.
So I'm really excited to see what happens when I go on and see if it will improve.
Oh, it'll continue to improve for several months, Bossy.
Yeah.
And this was the this was the MagRav unit from the latest one from Keshe Foundation.
Yeah.
Okay.
I'm also building my own, but that is not finished yet. So.
Mm-hmm. Well, you might end up building many more sets at this rate if you have continued success with it, and the rumor gets out.
Right. Yeah, the people I've been talking to is pretty happy about those results so far.
And tell me, do you find any other results that are interesting? Do you find that it changes anything in the room, or feel any vibes from the unit and all that kind of thing? I'm wondering.
Yeah, I've been trying to feel it out, but I can't really say I feel anything special.
Okay.
The one thing I was testing was because I've been doing 500 watts now, but just for 24 hours, I tried to put on an extra 1200 watts. And that was the first time I could sense on the unit it was a little warm. It wasn't hot, but it was a little warm.
Mm-hmm.
So I didn't want to run that permanently, but actually I'm going to try tomorrow to put on more load again and see if... Mm-hmm. If I still get it warm, or if that
yeah, a little bit warm is not an issue. If it pops the thermal breaker that's in there, you're just pushing it a little bit too hard.
Yeah.
But to warm it up, it's not a big deal. If it gets a little over comfortably warm, if it starts to feel hot, then yeah, shut it off. But if it's just comfortably warm, let it go, because in 24, 36, maybe even 48 hours, it'll cool right off, because the nano coating time and the speed of the coating is partly determined by how hard you load it.
Yeah, that's why I'm going to try now to put a little more load on it to see what happens.
So John,
I actually measured the temperature. It was 37 degrees. That was the most. So.
Oh, okay. The thermal breaker set.
Would you suggest, John, that it goes continuous, that's the best way to coat it, like you're mentioning, or would you allow it to heat up and then cool down period and heat up and cool down and so on, which would be better for nano coating?
In the latest manual reiteration that Vivek and I just worked on, we're stressing pulsing the resistive load so that we don't have these problems of people overheating their units. But if you're confident with what you're doing and you're aware of how things are working, run it up so it's warm and leave it. You're better, you're going to have good results that way. But for general purpose, for general people out there who aren't electrically minded or plasma minded, we stress, an hour on, 2 or 3 hours off, hour on, 2 or 3 hours off.
Right. I see. Okay. Thanks for clarifying that.
Well, I'm not so worried about 37 degrees, but the thing is, I'm not staying at this place overnight, so I don't want to leave it, like, maybe too long without
Yeah, so you know, taking a resistant load off for the night, it's just going to delay the process a little bit. It's not going to do any damage or not make it work.
Yeah, but I actually have a question to you guys, because my next step in testing now, I want to try to connect to, you know, I have a solar panel and batteries and stuff. So I would like to try to connect it to the inverter on my solar system. But I'm not sure if it's a good idea. What do you think?
Well, with what we found with the car, with the electric cars, is there is an issue with the inverters in the cars.
Uh-huh.
They do seem to have some issues with the plasma energy. So anybody who's doing the car systems or even like a solar system like you're suggesting, is we're recommending they use the car unit on the battery side.
Okay, yeah. Right. Maybe I'll try it anyway. Yeah. See what happens.
And really,
you can be a pioneer in the field, yes, yeah. Indeed.
Yeah, and really the only difference between the car unit and the house unit is the amount of capacitors that are in it.
Mm.
The rest of it's identical.
Yeah.
So if you're building your own system, if you make your coils coils properly, if you have problems with the coils, get a hold of me. You have my Skype, so I can help you through, walk you through that. So if you're making a set of coils, you're going to decide whether it's a low voltage or high voltage or car unit or a home unit just by how many capacitors you put on it.
Yeah, sure.
Hey, it's Lee here. I got a question. For the electric meter in your house, do you have to get a bidirectional meter? Or do these smart meters actually?
I have a smart meter
to measure stuff.
I have a smart meter, but then I also has I have my own wattmeter at the beginning of the chain.
Yeah, because my electrical bills have been way high, but it's because I've been running a steady load on my MagGrav units or my power units, so that's using power, which I normally wouldn't use.
Okay.
Yeah, we had one report. It's not substantiated, so I can't say it's actually accurate or not, but we've had one report of a fella in Canada with a smart meter that the smart meter realized what was going on and it started billing him for the power he was putting back into the system.
That's what I'm wondering happened to me, because like my electric bill for January was double, but as I say, I had a couple units going. They were loaded up with about 1200 watts steady, so I might have been using way more power than normal. So I was wondering if it was the darn smart meter was billing me for the MagGrav energy going out. I didn't know.
Maybe we should bill our smart meters for our usage. For their usage of our power. Wonder how they would think of that.
Well, it's easier for me because I know exactly what load I have all the time, so mm-hmm. I can compare very easy.
Yeah,
you're in an ideal circumstance that way for testing purposes.
I know when people have solar, I'm in Alberta here, just south of Calgary, and I know when they do solar here, they have to get a bidirectional meter installed.
Is that a bi-directional smart meter? Is that the idea?
I don't know, but I just got a standard dumb smart meter.
I thought the smart meters were put in place so that we could use the solar installations and be automatically have it go back on our bill, you know, against our bill. But I guess they outsmarted us on the smart meters that way.
No, go ahead.
The way it works in Sweden is that everybody that has a meter the last 3-4 years, they are smart meters, and you can go both direction with them. So
my understanding is the smart meters are pretty dumb, and the only reason they are installing them is so that they can send a signal in and get instantly what the usage is, so they can regulate their power generators.
Well, and also they can fire all the people that used to run around and take all the meter readings as well. So
exactly, yeah. but it's
not only just the usage that you're using, but the smart meters, they can tell what devices you're using. They can tell the difference between a TV and a radio and a computer and a light bulb.
Yeah.
Wow.
I'm not sure all the smart meters do that, but maybe some of them do.
Yeah, they're all capable of that type of sensing, apparently, and they send the signal off every few minutes or seconds or whatever to let home office know what's going on.
Well, what I read was there was, like, the meter's like just got a magnetic coil in there. It just senses power, but it doesn't really sense it, what direction it's going. It just senses power and bills you for the what power it senses. So that's, I was wondering, you know, I haven't researched it enough to really know what I'm talking about yet.
I think the biggest difference with the smart meters is that they can actually talk to it. You know, they can send messages back and forth. That's the smart thing about them, I guess.
Yeah.
I've got a really dumb meter on my house. It's just the really, really, really old meter with the two discs that spin. And if you're sucking power, they go one way. And if you're putting back, they reverse and go the other way. And I'm so happy. Hopefully no one's listening to this because I want it to stay the same.
That's exactly the kind of meter you want for a MagGrav unit.
Yeah, for sure.
Well, thank you very much, boss. I didn't hear the latest. The last time we talked, you were at 10% at 21 days, and I haven't heard anything since then. So thanks for coming on and letting us know what's going on out there.
Yeah, sure.
Yes, thanks very much.
Thanks, guys.
Okay, anybody else have something that you want to show here? I'm going to have to wrap things up fairly soon. I can go a bit extra here, but
Rick,
get ready for the
it's
online.
It's Lee here, if you want to.
Hi.
How you doing? I can show you my health cups I've been using for about 6 months.
All right.
And I've made a few for some people, and they're pretty happy with it. So I'll just share the video on my mobile phone. Can you see that okay?
Yes.
Oh, it's gone sideways on me. Hold on.
Yeah, I'm not sure which way is up here. There we go.
So I'll just zoom out a bit. So I've got three of them. You can see it's sort of like, you know, those gym workout cups you can get that come in separate.
Right.
And so you get the top bit there you can drink out of and put whatever fluid you want in the top. Then you've got two little compartments. So I pulled one apart there, and one of the compartments has got GANs, and then I made a custom little spring in the little mouth guard top bit there that goes on the lid. I'll just try and hold it and do GANs at once. It's kind of hard. But that goes on the top, and you screw it onto the GANs, right?
Mm-hmm.
And then in the center compartment, you can put whatever food you want. And in this one, I put like a protein powder. You know, like in Manitoba, you get those protein powder mixes. So this is a nice berry flavor, and I screw that, and I put that in the middle, and then that goes on top, screws on top, and then the lid goes on top just like the other ones. And very strong, very powerful. You get the flavor and the taste of the whatever you put in between in the water, and you can't drink too much. You just got to have little sips because it's too powerful throughout the day. People have been using them as well and saying, yeah, they can't drink too much because it's too strong.
Did you nano-coat your cups at all?
Sorry, go ahead.
Did you nano-coat your containers or your cups?
No need. Okay. So it's just with that GANs in the bottom and that custom spring that's nano-coated as well is strong enough. You can, within an hour, you can taste whatever's in the top cup. And with the found with the cup, you can go wash this, right? You don't have to mess with your GANs or whatever food you've got in the bottom. You can even get little separate containers and put, you know, they sell these separately and as kits for like $5. And
what is it meant for, to be able to carry your mixed stuff to put in your drink later or soup or something like that?
I just saw these at London Drugs just at Langford here, Rick. I was like, oh, these look cool. And then I looked them up online, and they're blender bottles. They're sort of tailored for like people that work out at the gym and want their protein powders and stuff like that.
Right.
You know, put their pills in and all this sort of stuff. And I was like, well, okay, I'll just, because I got tired of like messing with copper and putting wire around and all the plastic cups because it looked ugly, right? And I couldn't leave them lying around the house with kids coming over. So these are perfect. You can just leave them sit right next to your table, and they just like any regular cup.
And so it's ash in the bottom of your drinking cup.
Yes. And you can have your different varieties. So the green one's got my BC Mountain mix in there with my trail mix and nuts and fruit. This one's got my little multivitamins and dry coconut. And then this one's got my little protein powder if I'm really hungry. So it's
go, Cuzzy Bro.
So, but yeah, I've made these for a few people and they love them. You know, they can't get enough of them. So,
so what do you put in the bottom again?
Okay, let me go through that again. So, yeah, I got GANS in the lower one.
So, what kind of GANS would that be? Like a CO2 GANS?
CO2 GANS, yeah. Mm-hmm. And then you make your spring. And you put that sort of little mouth guard. You could put that in the upper one. You got flexibility here to however you want to design it, really. But this is what I did. I made my own little spring there and nano-coated it. And you can put GANS on that too, but you don't need it. So much GANS here, it's strong. Comes up.
That looks like one single spring that's been pulled apart in the center. Is that right?
No, it's all one wire. And then I one spring on side, and then it joins the other side. So.
Okay.
Yeah. So, yeah. You can do whatever you want in there, whatever you want to fit in that plastic separate compartment. But this is just what I did. You know, it's up to you.
Mm-hmm.
It seemed really cool. I was like, wow, I can fit something in there in a separate compartment and you can pull it out. And then, so that's the GANS spring sort of, I suppose you'd call it a little reactor, wouldn't you? Like GANS and spring and a plastic thing. And then you can put your little matter in here and you can swap it in and out with whatever matter you want. But I just leave it dedicated by having separate cups. But if you had just the one cup, you could swap it in and out with whatever mm-hmm. meals you want. And then you've got your little dedicated cups. So I remember now, so I don't get confused if I drink one or the other. There's some really strong, the multivitamins in here is really strong. You can't drink too much of that.
I have a question, if I can ask you. Does the GANS, once you've flavored the GANS or whatever, does it stay flavored from then on? Do you still need to put the food in it? And if you change the food, does it change the flavor?
All right, those are about four questions, I think, in that statement there. I'll try and answer it. So the GANS, I've made these cups, so I haven't touched them in 6 months. I just fill up the water every week with a big 2 liter of water and top it up and then just have little sips throughout every day throughout the week. That's what I do.
Mario, the plasma energy is always going to go from the strongest source to the weaker source, just like the air pressure in the atmosphere. It always goes from the high pressure to the low pressure. So your GANS is not going to pick up whatever is your adjunct is. It's going to remain the same. The energy is going to travel through the adjunct, be modified by that adjunct, and then into your water. It won't go the other direction.
You're not storing the food flavor in the GANS, then?
No. No, the GANS is the strongest plasma source, so it's going to be radiating out constantly.
Oh, I see. Yeah. Okay. Thinking upside
the down. Way that Alex changes the so-called condition of his GANS is that he puts, let's say, a banana right on top of the GANS capture kit. So at the point of the creation of the GANS, that then takes on the energy of the banana. But if you do it in this way, after the GANS is created, like what John said, the plasma is going to flow through the adjunct into the water and energize it.
Really good point, Vivek. Thank you for clarifying.
Yeah, that's awesome, yeah. Plus with the nano spring, you've got the boost too. Yeah.
So you can condition the GANS, but you have to make the GANS with the banana on top, like that.
Right. That's one way, for example, to take the food nanomaterial, which is created with food plus caustic, and then you put that into the GANS when it's created, and you can impart the fields of the food into the GANS as it's being made.
So yeah, so you got your GANS layer, your spring, and nuts and fruit, and then the water on top. And the water just tastes like velvet syrup. It's just amazing. So.
Okay, thanks for Thanks for sharing that. It's good.
No worries. Yeah. So they've sold out at London Drugs, but if you look online, it's the blended bottle. You can get it on Amazon for about $13. Mm-hmm. A bit more money, of course. They're not your real special, Rick. The $2 would be great, but
yeah. Well, you know, this is special, and it's very specific, and it looks, you know, it's got all the right stuff for being a good, efficient way of dealing with it. It's clean, and you know, everything's sealed up. It's more versatile than the cup that I have, and so on. It's almost, this would be, the cup I have might be more of a healing cup, and this would be more of a cup of life in terms of food, sustenance, and a cup of energy, you might say.
Yeah, I think it blends well if you got other people around. They're not going to be questioning what that cup is, or, you know, you got to worry about, you know, the looks and too many questions, right? Especially if you had like an office and you had this on your office and your desk, and wouldn't get any questions, right? But if you had copper and wire and cans all around it, people would be like, what's going on? So that's sort of where I came up with this.
Yeah. It's cool. Much more office friendly.
Yes.
Well, in some circumstances that actually makes a big difference, and I think Leith could probably tell some tales about that, as far as getting in trouble with Keshe Technologies with your employer and that kind of thing.
Yes.
So we do have to be a little careful about exposing ourselves if we're hired
social media. You've got to look at your employees' policies on social media, look at the fine print. So
good point.
Be careful.
You're eating less food.
Oh yeah, when I first used these the first month, I didn't want to eat. I'd go up to the kitchen and, you know, I'm just like, oh, I'm not hungry, and then my body started to freak out. I was just like, oh, I started to feel alien, you know. I just didn't want to eat, and it was just too much. I had to calm down and not use them so much every day. So I just have a little sip every day. I don't, you know, guzzle on it. It's too much.
Right, good point. Yeah. So do you feel you get sort of hyper energetic or something, or?
I used to, but now it's totally calm now. So I don't eat meat anymore, and I used to barbecue every week, but now I don't eat meat. Mm-hmm. I just eat, you know, light stuff like bread, a bit of fruit, cereal. I've just cut back.
A lot of people are having a similar response when using these health cups. It's quite amazing that way.
Yeah, I think it's a transition, and as long as I don't get a big head or lose my mouth too soon, I'm going to be okay. But yeah, it's just, I think like Keshe said, it is transitioning us somehow, our body, to what we need. It's an efficient way to eat, if you think about it, because you just don't consume as much food. You don't go to the grocery store and buy all this unnecessary stuff.
That's right, yeah. Yeah, Douglas had a lot of good things to say that way. He basically quit smoking and quit eating meat and a bunch of other things and healed quite well.
Yeah, I haven't touched a drop of alcohol since I can't remember. It's amazing, and I usually used to drink every week. So yeah, it's changed a lot of things physically, and then yeah, there's a lot of motion and other stuff too. But that's related to these guys, these rack, just three of them in the room. It's just it's just crazy.
Mm-hmm.
So the plasma is through the roof, and then comes into my bedroom and enters your chakras and does all sorts of stuff. But it's getting really spiritual, Rick, to be honest. It's quite amazing. So
good for you. I'm glad you're creating there and keeping that going.
Yeah, it's bizarre. I look at my bill online through BC Hydro, if you can see my screen there, and try and monitor it. But I've got the smart meter too, and I monitor it. And it's hard to say with the smart meter, and I don't think they are bi-directional, the ones here in BC. So it looks like you have to get a permit to get approved. I'll switch that off because it's personal. So anyway,
excellent. Thank you very much.
Cool. Thanks.
Hi there, everyone. May I speak?
Yes, go ahead.
Thank you. It's Alper from California.
Hi, Elmer.
I just wanted to share a little experience, and after that, it came an idea related to a potential spacecraft captain. I would say it might shed a light. I feel that it would have a potential to take it to a point. So I woke up.
Do you have anything you want to share there, or a video or anything, or should I just put an image
I'll show myself.
Okay, that'd be good. Thank you. You just need something for the recording here.
I'm sorry, I understand.
I can put up a video if you, or a picture, but.
I may not look quite decent.
Oh, that's all right.
Thank you. So I woke up with the feeling where I have this really wonderful feeling inside me, and I can't really describe it. It feels like a regular, you had a dream, but you can't remember the dream, and you like to try to remember the dream constantly, but it is impossible. But you have the beauty of the dream in you as a feeling, and then you go on with your day and with that feeling, and then you suddenly see something, which I have seen as a flower. It made me remember the dream totally. I was there, and I realized the feeling. I remember the feeling, why I had the feeling in me, which it led me to a point where I've been thinking about the captain of the spacecraft, what would be the scenario, like practical scenarios, where I thought, how would, with my limited understanding, how would the captain start the spacecraft and move? Which it led me to a point, we can remember the specific feelings via seeing specific objects in our mind's eyes. This feeling that I had in the whole day, and which means seeing the flower and just remembering the whole thing, it could be sort of reverse engineered in terms of you see the picture in your mind's eye and then you're there. And then what I've tried was really interesting. I have a sort of meditated state. I have poured a lemon into my mouth. And I wanted to feel the feeling where you get this really tingly feeling in your tongue, in your mouth. And you get it eventually. You suddenly have more saliva in your mouth, as if you've really licked a lemon. And this could be, I realized this could be a hint to actually control the emotions in a way where we could be specific. And so it may be is very simple, just using this sort of technique. I don't know if I may. This is a question also, perhaps it makes sense or not, but.
Well, yeah, I think it definitely makes sense. And if you can work on that question inside yourself a bit, it'd be a good question maybe for Mr. Keshe in the Knowledge Seekers Workshop. We've touched on this before, the idea of visualization and how it can make changes in the body, and you can direct your emotions and so on. We just have to get more specific about it and ask, some kind of specific question that could lead to more knowledge about that. So, yeah, continue experimenting and continue thinking about that.
Oh no, we should all do that. Just the lemon example is quite effective, where it comes to a point where you actually produce saliva as if you're eating.
Yeah, absolutely. I can do that now and have that happen. yeah, that works.
There was several studies done years and years ago that determined that until we learn to rationalize, our mind, our brain can't tell the difference between imagination and reality. They did this test with young children. And before they learned to view their world in a very specific, very boxed way, for lack of a better term, they were their imagination was their world. Now, we haven't lost that. All we've done is we've learned how to mask it with rationality.
Look, you touched an amazing point where you're using the children's, because I think we need to feel the feelings of where we were children before, where we were a child, and like as if we're. The reason I'm telling you because I felt like a children when I'm near the plasma, and the feeling that it gives me, and I remember the raw feeling of too many things. Just because you mentioned being a child, and it reminded me, I think we should investigate that as well. Go ahead, please, sir.
No, I have some information from the study in the Flower of Life.
Okay.
It's directly related to this about human perceptions. I didn't really go into it, but I don't know if there's time to do it now, but have you ever heard of Plato's allegory of the cave? Remember that? The man lives in the cave, he sees the shadows on the wall, he thinks that's the universe. I was showing the Flower of Life, if you cover one eye, it becomes curved and it looks like 3D. But Mr. Keshe said our ancestors had one eye. The rest of the universe sees.
Yes, I remember that.
Well, we are the ones that are seeing in the optical illusion with our stereoscopic vision. The thing with the Pythagorean theorem, the Pythagorean tuning of a guitar string where he took the harmonics, he took ratios and turned them into absolute values. It's exactly the same thing as trying to understand why Beethoven sounds harmonious as opposed to a bunch of sound or noise by trying to calculate the frequencies of the notes. It can't be done. Mathematics is useless. It's a ratio-based system. When you pluck a guitar string, we think the fundamental note is the octave, like if you pluck an A. But I just showed you the Flower of Life, the field is actually radiating out from the center of the string, where we call it the first harmonic overtone. That's not the first harmonic overtone, that's the center of the field, radiating out 360 degrees from there. We got it upside down. We're looking at it in reverse. We think the fundamental tone is the lower octave, and the other notes, the harmonic overtones, are derived. That's wrong. That's the wrong way to think. It's upside down and backwards. The periodic table of elements. Mr. Keshe has to add the atomic masses to get, you know, copper plus oxygen plus zinc, you get CO2. But in reality, you're supposed to, you actually subtract the frequencies. I might be losing you here. My internet's unstable. Me too.
No, I can hear you.
But we live, what Pythagoras did is he took the Pythagorean tuning and turned it into absolute values, invented mathematics to invent geometry. So that he turns ratios into absolute values with the mathematics, and then turns the spherical universe into flat lines. He measures it on the wall. He's going the wrong way. He's trying to take the spherical ratio-based universe and turn it into what it looks like on his wall. We all are doing that. We all are seeing mirages that don't exist. We see straight lines that don't exist. We're the ones that are in the cave. The cave is our minds. Our two eyes are deceiving us. children are closer to the reality than we are, because the older you get, the more used to seeing the world with optical illusions. You know, I could go on and show you.
We could go on, but we need to end here very shortly, unfortunately. It's just starting to get interesting in a way. But that's a very good point, I think, that we do live in a world of illusion, and we keep thinking that what we see is the real thing. But
use mathematics. And there's a number of things. Mr. Kess said, we're going to start seeing UFOs. And I know almost everybody thinks, the aliens are going to make themselves visible to us. Wrong. It's us that are going to come out of the cave. It's they're there. We're the ones that don't see them because we're looking with two eyes. And it's something else. Mm-hmm. I've experienced this over and over again. Almost everything I learn, most of the things, I feel more like I'm remembering something I've forgotten than I'm learning something new, because it's in our RNA. We are remembering something we've forgotten. Our ancestors knew this information. We're the ones.
It's Back to the Future, Mario.
Yeah, in a way, yeah. But that perception, human perceptions, if I have a book here called The Knowledge of Higher Worlds, written in 1910. The guy describes the universe as a sphere inside a sphere inside a sphere. Rudolf Steiner, one of the most important guys, Tesla group, that whole thing. He says, if you're going to attain these higher worlds, these other spheres, you must first have a knowledge of their existence. If you don't know they exist, you're not going to try to attain something you don't know exists. If we're not aware that we're seeing illusions, if we're not aware that we're living in a mind, in a cave of our own mind's deception, then really you're not going to come out of it. And that, I think more importantly than the reactors I built, I was just trying to see if I understood the blueprint. I built the reactor, and turns out now I know, I built a spaceship. You know, I learned that later, really. I mean, I was following the blueprint. It's what I'm just saying to you now, this thing of our perception is the most important thing that information I got from this. And it's really important, especially not ready for prime time. You know, in the workshop, I don't think people are ready to prepare themselves to realize that they can't trust their own two eyes.
Well, we should maybe get into that in the next workshop. It would be a good topic to pursue, I think. It's becoming more and more important, this relationship of our perceptions and our emotions, how it ties into the equation of who we are and what is our spiritual nature and this kind of thing. But for now, we don't have time to get into all the intricate details. And sometimes it takes time to warm up to get to that. Pardon me?
Should I go on to the workshop tomorrow, or do you think I should wait?
It might be time for that. I'm not sure what's lined up. I don't have a lot lined up for the workshop. So if you want to sort of prepare to get into that, that would be great.
I don't have to zoom.
You know, your diagram there would be great, especially if you had a tripod to hold the camera so it wasn't shaky, so we get a nice clear image, and that would really be useful. I think Kes should be quite impressed with that concept. I know a lot of people would key into the whole flower of life concept, which many people are triggered by and interested in. So yeah, that could be useful, I think.
I need the Zoom ID, and then I'll leave it to you. If it's time, then put me on. If it's not, then I'm okay. You know, I'm not going to... I'll leave it up to you, you know?
Yeah, it's I always just work in the moment that way and just try to let people sort of naturally things emerge and all that. But yeah, I think it'd be great if you could be on standby for that, Mario.
Yeah, so I need to have the Zoom ID, I guess.
Okay, it's the same every week. So it's the same for all the Knowledge Seekers workshops. And I can get that just a second. I'll put it in the chat here. Let me
That was a big message I got recently spiritually, Rick, was the flower of life. It said in order to achieve it, we've got to make sure no man, woman, or child is without food, water, or shelter.
Yeah.
Until we achieve that, we don't really deserve to see the flower of life.
Food, water, shelter, and without peace in terms of not being abused as well, because you can have food, water, and shelter and still be abused, and that's not okay these days.
So what it is we failed as a human race. That's what I interpret. I got it as a vibration. I got these vibration levels going off. My feet start shaking, my hands start shaking, and wakes me up in the middle of the night because I think my vibes have gone up a whole level.
The big message I got was
no man, woman, or child should be without food, water, or shelter in order to be an effective human species.
And that's right.
That's what we're failing. There's billionaires out there, and then there's homeless people and children with poverty. Yeah. You know, and it's quite simple, right? But it shouldn't be that way. And that's the message I've got. And if we establish it, we'll see a flower of life. We'll see a grid. We'll see the new dimensions opening us to achieve, you know, what we're trying to achieve.
That's right. That's why the message of the Keshe Foundation is so important and so on.
Yeah. And it is definitely a big topic, and I could share a lot more about it, but yeah, it's getting late now, and it's getting sleepy time for me, so I appreciate it. Thanks.
Alrighty, I'm going to wrap it up now. Really appreciate all the input tonight. It was very dynamic. People from giving different inputs is excellent. Okay, maybe next week I'll get an earlier start on things as well, so a bit late today. I was snoozing on the job, you might say. All right, so that's it for today for Keshe Plasma Reactor Group for Wednesday, March 2nd, 2016. And thank you, everybody, for attending.
Thanks, Rick. Thanks, everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone.